My name is Bob Shustak. I'm a co-chair of the State Civil Litigation Section. I'm here to welcome you today to Tom Klein's Real World in the Courtroom, Real Testimony, Real Trials. Tom Klein is the catalytic difference maker of our generation. Judge Bill Manfredi, I ran into him in the hallway, calls Tom one of the masters of our universe. His energy, his standards, vision, innovations, and powers of persuasion are truly inspiring. He believes in people and gives voice to those who otherwise would have none. Tom delivers hope and much needed aid and relief to those at the brink. He is a lawyer on the side of people. Many of you may not know, some of you may, that he was raised in a small blue-collar coal mining town of Hazleton, PA. He's the son of a dress factory manager, and he graduated from the small college of Albright in 1969, summer of 69. He taught sixth grade social studies for 6 years, and Judge Moss tells me that perhaps it should be mandatory requirement for trial lawyers for understanding and speaking to any jury. As a teacher, Tom realized that we must approach jurors like people in our everyday life in an open and forthright way by being truthful and faithful to ourselves and by being ourselves in life and as trial lawyers. Jury respect is earned. It's not something that's bestowed. Tom earned a master's degree, another little known fact till I looked at his unbelievable resume online, in history, American history, and he completed all the PhD work and then decided to go to law school and graduated from Duquesne, and no surprise, he got the Distinguished Student Award there, Law Review, and a couple other things you would expect from Tom. Then he went on to law clerk for the venerable Justice Thomas W. Pomeroy. After that, he chose, thankfully, to represent people, and I think to change the world. He dedicated his career to justice, professional excellence, and respect for the rule of law. He joined the firm of the great Jim Beasley, and there were some incredible years where he accelerated in and out of the courtroom and where he learned the art and science of medicine, epidemiology, a concept that most of us don't want to learn about, engineering precepts, and evidentiary preeminence. At that point, I think in the chain of the career, his creative genius emerged in front of all of us as he honed his remarkable skills. And there in the Beasley firm, he met his unstoppable counterpart, his balance, Shane Inspector, and together, 1995, they co-founded Klein Inspector, which is recognized by many as one of the most powerful law firms in Philadelphia and certainly one of the best in the country. And we all followed Tom's epic career with the Blum case, the Pier 34, the Motiva refinery explosion case, and many of us know that Tom played a key role in the Vioxx litigation, which led to a $4.5 billion settlement. And there were so many more victories. My personal favorite, Tom, is is always the four-year-old Sharif Hall's case against SEPTA, where the escalator tore the innocent child's foot off and SEPTA engaged in a heinous cover-up. I think if any of you remember back, who can forget the outrage when SEPTA blamed Sharif's mother, her name was Deneen, and I remember the first thing that struck me back when that case was going on was the photograph of the boy's black FILA boot, and it had a white shoelace on it that SEPTA claimed caused this catastrophe. But in reality, the boot had a black shoelace that was tied, so the black shoelace that the kid had on was retrieved from the escalator. So, and what Tom did, and this is where the creative genius emerges, is he told the jury that SEPTA had never so much as offered to pay Sharif's mother $65 to replace his little FILA boot. And he asked the jury to make sure that whatever they awarded to Sharif's mom, that it ended in the number 65. So what happened is the jury returned a verdict of $1 million and $65 for the mom's emotional distress claim. And they slammed SEPTA with a $50 million for Sharif's brutal losses and the civil rights violations. And how cool was that? And I think, to her credit, Judge Messiah Jackson presided over that, and she saw disregard for court process that Tom brought out during the trial, extreme bad faith, obstruction of justice, and she fined SEPTA $1 million for its conduct. So Tom Klein truly believes that something good can come out of something really bad. He preaches justice and just social change. Yet his most important and most significant case, he will tell you, is the one he's working on at the present time. I could go over his recognitions, but I would take the entire hour, but I would like just to point out that he is a member and immediate past president of the prestigious Inner Circle of Advocates, described by the Washington Post as, quote, a select group of 100 of the nation's most celebrated trial lawyers. If any of you watch television and watch the Phillies or Sixers, Tom is a raging Sixers and Phillies fan. It's the only thing he studies more than his pending cases seem to be Cliff Lee and Roy Halladay. Tom, I was there at the September 15th game when Cliff Lee had a perfect game going almost. Ninth inning, two outs, two strikes, and Joe Lopez hits the ball out of the park, ties the game up, so Cliff Lee loses his seventh consecutive shutout. But Ryan Howard, who many of us are on right now, came back, hit a double, and we won the game in the 10th. So trial law, I suggest to you, emulates baseball, because as trial lawyers, we can pitch 8 2/3 flawless innings and still need our legal team to secure a victory. So it certainly comes as no surprise that the Philadelphia Daily News has called Tom the Babe Ruth of personal injury litigation. Simply stated, Tom is among the greatest of courtroom innovators and advocates, a visionary, a creative force who has had a profound impact on the landscape of civil justice. And with all the accolades, all of Tom's achievements, record verdicts and settlements he has won, Tom never forgets from where he came. In his office, there's displayed a framed letter dated April 29, 1969, from his father on the occasion of his graduation from college. And it is Tom's personal source of motivation, as I understand it, and it serves as a constant reminder from his dad that he would achieve great things in life, especially with the strong support of his family growing up. So I think, Tom, with your dad's inspiration and pride over 40 years in your heart, he must certainly proclaim today, attaboy, and I told you so. So honorable judges, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming our keynote speaker, Tom Klein.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Bob. Gee, I didn't want to get up. I just wanted to stay seated. I have a badge here. As I was sitting here listening to Bob, and it says President Judge Pamela Demby. So I got a promotion. And I think I'll just put it on and get started. The Phillies. We could talk about the Phillies for starters. I was asked by a lot of people in emails, where was I on that fifth game? And I had my response down to a science. When asked the question, are you going to be there, my response was, no, period, think Koufax, period. So I didn't make it there. I viewed my role here today in the last hour before a three-hour cocktail party as largely entertainment. And the only question for those of you who would like to take the CLE credit when it's all over is to ask the question whether you deserve it at the end of all of this, because I selected pretty much over a long period of time and clips and testimony, the things that I thought would entertain you. So I make no bones about it. And What I've tried to caption as the theme, as you can see from the weighty words of Voltaire, is that questions in a courtroom are really important. I know for all of his and her honors in the room here today that you tell the members of the jury that you should not regard the questions but rather the answers. And I would suggest to you that maybe you'll see some questions here that kind of suit your fancy. The other thing that I would say is that there are, over the course of trials, a lot of things that happen and a lot of things that happen spontaneously. And my goal again today is to show you a lot of things that happened spontaneously. At least my adopted pedagogical style, if you will, for conducting these kinds of groups and for teaching CLE has largely become this is what I've done and this is how I've approached it, and you can for yourself analyze it and see whether you think it's good, bad, or indifferent. Now, having switched from Voltaire and being a relatively recent grandfather, I would tell you that this is the next peg in our little event. The wise old owl lives in an oak. The more he heard, the less he spoke. The less he spoke, the more he heard. Why can't we be like that wise old bird? How many have heard it? To me, it means that you have to listen, and you have to listen to the answer, and you have to go to the next to the question after you've gone to the after you've heard the answer. Some of the things that I'm going to present here today, I presented recently in a continuing legal education course at Drexel Law, where I sit on the board of advisors, and it was billed to the alumni. And of course, anyone who is going to speak to the alumni of a law school who now has graduated two classes, you say to yourself, I'm going to speak to young lawyers. So while many in this room appear to be very seasoned and very experienced, and many judges in the room, that to me has always been really, truly guiding principle. We brought materials here today, and for those of you who don't have a copy, Bob Zausner wrote a fantastic book. Bob is a former Inquirer reporter. Where is Bob, by the way? He's here somewhere, in case you want to grab him to sign a copy. And at the end of this, feel free, if you don't own a copy, to come up and take a copy. Bob mentioned Hall versus SEPTA. Hall versus SEPTA was, I still believe, a landmark case in our region for many reasons and served many purposes in terms of public safety and in terms of, in our smaller world, the adjudication of claims and how claims should be legitimately and properly handled by claims departments and insurance companies and public agencies. But Bob writes a very interesting book. It describes two cases, one involving a young man who was horribly injured and later died from a BB gun accident, a Daisy gun, which should have been off the shelves, which wasn't, and which my great law partner, Shane Inspector, handled. The other is the story of Hall versus SEPTA and the really the kind of inside story of it. And if you'd like a copy, that constitutes our written materials here today, and Bob's also happy to talk to you about it. Upcoming, another unabashed advertisement before I go any further, is a book called Bad Break, which is a story of my law partner Shannon's epic battles with Ford Motor Company. And I've read the manuscript, and it's a great manuscript. The third of a trilogy, which is going to eventually be published, involves a case which I tried in front of Her Honor Judge Quinones, involving the Mateo trial, involving a OBGYN who herself died during an attempt to get pregnant during fertility treatment. and you're going to see a piece of that here today. So the hopefully wise old owl will show you something about that. Last point is, for those of you, last advertisement, then we'll get on to business. For those of you who are Bob Dylan fans like myself, any in the room? I have a son who's a third-year law student and a playwright with a master's degree, who's a huge and long-standing Bob Dylan fan with me. We've gone to over 100 concerts in a bunch of continents, and we're doing a CLE at the Wilma November 11th entitled Bob Dylan Law, Lyrics, Music, for those of you who want an easy sit-back, 3 credits, a CLE, with live entertainment and music and the whole deal. So that'll be a continuation if you get through this afternoon. So with that in mind, here's what I want to do. I have had a number I've selected a number of pieces from trials that literally go back a few decades. I've been doing this now since literally 1980, when I walked into a courtroom with the late, great James E. Beasley and did not know which side of the courtroom to sit on. I was straightened out by that later when Nancy Fulham joined the firm and taught me a lot of what I know, along with a lot of other great lawyers in that firm. But I want to start with a case that I tried just a few years ago. It's a case involving loss of a child by a wonderful couple, the Gulicks. It was tried in Lehigh County. It involved a youngster who was just born, who had a hernia that needed to be repaired. It was repaired successfully, but unfortunately he had prematurity of his lungs, and it quickly caused his death when they put him under anesthesia. Liability, interestingly, wasn't contested, and the defendants convinced the judge to reverse bifurcate the trial. That concept seemed to have spread, Judge Moss, from the asbestos programs to the courtrooms in Lehigh County. Later, the judge, Judge Black, actually came and spoke to our judges at one of the lunchtime conversations and had an interesting discussion. The trial became about only the damages, and as a result of which, there was an interesting dynamic. Ordinarily, those of us who litigate civil cases involving damages, how many people are in that category in this room? Sure. And usually, the damages, and the economist in particular, kind of become an afterthought. There's some cross-examination, it's not intensive. But here, the whole focus was on the economist himself, and on the kind of nitty-gritty in a time when we had changes in the law. So the defendant brought a defense economist to the witness stand, and as we walk through the slides, you'll get a feel for what happened and how he was handled on cross-examination. So here we go. Here's one of many different things in a what I would call potpourri that I came to have you see today. And I hope you can see in the back. Is it okay? Good. I'm marking your report as D1, and the table attached is D1A. This was the first piece of your work product for this case for the defendants in this lawsuit, namely your letter, and we'll hold Margaret for a minute, that was dated November 29, 05, correct. Now what happened was, you're going to see that a mistake was made, which is I turn into a molehill. You know what I mean by turning it into a molehill? And the reason is he tried to change his report and issued a supplemental report 2 days after trial began. He came prepared to testify with a addendum to the report because there was a mistake in the first report. And the mistake in the first report was what he would describe as a small mistake involving the miscalculation of fringe benefits. Fringe benefits, by all admitted views, is somewhere between 5% and 10% of the wage standard, of the wage package. And of course, there's an interesting dynamic that occurs in cases that involve death claims for children. And that is, under Pennsylvania law, recently, of course, there was a major change in the allowance of profound emotional distress to parents. And that's a major advance in the law, a recent Superior Court opinion. But we have very little to work with. You have pain and suffering. You have now profound emotional distress. And then you have this artifact, this concept of trying to tell jurors that they actually should put a monetary value on future economic loss of a child who not only never worked, but in this case, lived all of a few days. So we're looking here at a battle of economists. And so I'm asking him if this was his report, his first report, if you will. And here's where we went. Correct. I said, your report was dated November 29th, if we can start highlighting the top. That was his report pre-trial. Next. November 29th, it says, attached is my analysis of present value of lost earnings for Connor Gulick. You really meant lost earning capacity. Correct? Correct. Now, you submit a report to the lawyers, and you have the annual gross income of $36,142. And then you have an increase for fringe benefits at $471, correct? Everybody following along? Okay, good, I have the stage set. Correct. Now, we know, sir, that that is wrong. Now, I know he's going to tell me that's wrong because he's issued a supplemental report. Answer? That was incorrect, yes. Question? Now, we know, sir, that was wrong, correct? That was incorrect, yes. That's because, by the way, these are exact transcripts and parens are getting you through it. That's because even you acknowledge fringe benefits are 5%, not 1% as suggested. 5% is a low end, and the battle in these cases is often whether the plaintiff's economist says it's more and the defense says it's less, but never less than 5. Next. And what you did was you, to take the earnings, you add the fringe benefits. How many know this drill? You add the fringe benefits, you subtract the personal consumption, you get a net loss, and then cumulative each year do a running total called a cumulative loss. How many have seen something like this in their practice? Nearly everybody. Next. Correct. We're doing pretty good, by the way. When you get correct, you're doing okay. Next. Well, sir, that fringe benefit in every one of these columns is wrong, correct? Yes, that's why I submitted a new report. Question. I didn't ask you that question. I simply asked you if this is wrong. Yes. Your new report was submitted after the trial began. It's dated January 5th. Answer. The 4th, then, if it was the 5th, yes, after the trial began. Your new report, after the trial began, you faxed a report, this time using 5%, correct? Yes. Okay, now, since this fringe benefit of 1.6 being $471 is wrong, this entire column is wrong. I, at one time, yes, Bob, was a sixth grade teacher, and yes, I don't get through a trial without saying it. So by marking this up, then the entire fringe benefit column would be wrong, correct? That column was incorrect. This is called magnifying an error. Next, since the fringe benefit figure is wrong, the net loss figures are all wrong, correct? And by the way, I did this in the courtroom the old-fashioned way with a board, like as in, let's make an old-fashioned blow-up so that we have something to do, not electronically. You're getting the electronic sanitized version. That's correct. Am I doing pretty good on the as a teacher here? Next. So that column's all wrong, correct. And finally, sir, since the, so this column is all wrong. And finally, sir, since the fringe benefit figure is wrong, and since the annual net loss figure is wrong, then the whole cumulative loss figure is wrong. Correct? That's correct. And everything that's wrong on the first page would be continued to be wrong on the second page. Correct? Now we have, by the way, now, as you say in the courtroom, you have something going. Okay, so we have this now in front of us all. And I then ask the question, have you been teaching, sir, at the Harvard Business School? And the answer was, yes, I have. And the question is, how would you grade yourself on this report? Now, and old teacher asked the question. Now, how many judges do we have in the room? Like a few. And how many are going to sustain the objection? Oh, man. No. No, it doesn't get sustained. It's a fair question how he's going to grade himself. So let's see what Judge Black did with it, your colleague from Lehigh County. Objection. Answer. I think it's fair. I think it's fair he would have graded himself. That's also not a sidebar type issue. That's like out in the open. And the answer is objection overruled. Now, by the way, if the objection had been sustained, for those who are practitioners, okay, but let's see where it goes. Okay, sir, what kind of grade would you give the paper that you submitted on November 29, 2005 in anticipation of this trial and to be presented to the jury? Like, how would you, we've got to grade you. Isn't that what, by the way, assessing experts is all about? Here's where we come. Answer. Oh, let's look at it one more time, because I was standing there at this point, and the answer is, I'd give it a 95 because. And you could read his answer, but he basically says the basic concept of discontinuing, this is when the expert tries to talk over you. Because and properly and earnings and the personal consumption were done properly and obviously had a computer error. Now it's a computer error that led me to be off by 4 or 5% from the actual total. So I knocked 5 points off the grade, discounting it to present value, and the earnings were done properly and the personal consumption was done properly. He said that already. I'm sitting on my chair. I'm listening patiently. And I said, let's give it an A. Because he said it was a 95, and a 95 is an A. And he said, no, well, it's a 95. And I said, 95's an A. Now we're debating on my terms, by the way, on my turf. And his answer was, it depends on where you are. And I said, oh, yeah. And he said, looking at it one more time, I said, I walked up to the board and I put an A. So, is that it, Margaret? So, how many graded an A? Thank you. All right, now, moving from that, that's a warm-up. I tried a case, it was many years ago now. It's the Mateo trial before Judge Quinones. And this examination that you're going to see did not involve, I think, maybe it involved a couple of objections, because I think they tried to, but it involves, it's an interesting case. Suzanne Wester was a much beloved obstetrician-gynecologist who was married to Tony Mateo, who was also an obstetrician-gynecologist. And there's a long, complicated story, which was the subject of a many, many week trial. But for purposes here, you need to know the following. The defense came into the courtroom to basically say that the plaintiff's criticism of the defendant physician, the fertility specialist, was incorrect in that we claim that she never should have been on aspirin or heparin therapy because it was a blood thinner and it made her a setup for a bleed, which happened. During fertility treatment, they do an oocyte retrieval. Oocyte retrieval involves taking the eggs from the ovary, involves usually some amount of bleeding, in fact, always some amount of bleeding. And so if you're on a blood thinner, you have a greater chance of bleeding. Defendant expert who comes in, a self-proclaimed controversial figure, comes in and says that, no, the treatment was appropriate because Dr. Mateo, the patient, had a low blood count, a low platelet count. She had something called thrombophilia. Thrombophilia patients are appropriately treated this way because it enhances their ability to get pregnant. So they bring in a physician. His name is Dr. Beer, I think spelled the way it sounds. And he comes in to offer an opinion for the defense. And of course, the linchpin of saying that someone was treated appropriately because they had a low platelet count, the evidentiary basis of that is, of course, what? That the person actually has a low platelet count. Let's see what happened. So we have the cross-examination from the actual transcript. So I'm going to ask you some questions on cross-examination. Now, I like to do this with a witness who I've read 20 or 30 or 50 transcripts of and know that that witness is not going to give me yes and no answers. So here's what I ask. Have you previously been through cross-examination? Answer, yes. Question, on how many occasions, sir? Answer, three. I thought it was more when I started. This is my goal, to pin you down. My questions will be directed to asking you for specific information, and I will be asking for a specific response. Do you understand that? Answer, I understand. I often do this or something like that because I like a jury to know and understand that I'm not being confrontational for the point or the practice of being confrontational, but rather because I have a job to do. It's something that by definition needs to cut people off. You have to get to the, you know, the core of it. You can't let people talk. And I sometimes like to do this in some way in many long trials through at least one witness. And he says, I understand. And you do understand that as part of the process, you'll be able to come up, doctor, defendant's lawyer's going to be able to come up and ask you anything he wants to explain, and all I want to do is pin you down, and here's my point, because you're going to see how I tie this together. Because it was late in the day, very late in the day, we were being kept by a very strict judge who wanted us to finish this witness. And I said, it's late in the day and everybody wants to go home. Do you understand? Answer, I understand. Question. Now let's move on. And I want to read very carefully the next part of your report. Her platelet count on 11/15/94 was 146,000, and this is low. Is that correct? I meant, is your report correct? It's low, below 100,000, which is low, low. Question, is it a correct statement that on 11/15/94, this patient, Suzanne Wester, her blood count, her platelet count, was 146,000? Where do you think this is all headed? Correct statement. Next. And sir, we established earlier in that event she had a blood count that was in the normal, and as we established earlier, in the event that she had a blood count that was in the normal range, 250,000 or something like that, then it would not form the basis of your opinion. Correct? Yes. It is a key piece of information. It was a key piece of information for me, yes. And what did you base it on? I based it on the records that I reviewed with the laboratory results. Question? And did you review the actual record? Answer? Yes. Question? Did you look at it today? Like, that would be a good idea in my view. But I wanted to see when the last time he had it, because I wanted to get a feel for whether this was going to crash and burn or had a chance for salvage for him. That was my feeler. That was my tester. And the answer was, no, I haven't looked at it today. Okay. Since when? Figured, why not find out? 6 weeks ago. That's like being prepared. So you looked at it when you did the report, you looked at it again when you reviewed and prepared to come to testify, correct? Yes, when he came to prep me for my appearance. Okay, let's get a copy of it out. Why would the physician have written most significant? It was written in the doctor's note. This is the most significant piece of information. Because I was basically getting at that the defendant had this wrong too. Answer, perhaps for the same reason I would. Your expert always, you always want your expert, for those of you who do this work, to support the person who they're there on behalf of, for the same reason. You believe it's significant because the patient had a platelet of 146,000, and the platelet count would be low. That would show she had thrombophilia, correct? And by the way, in terms of the teaching techniques, and those of you who have seen me do this before know, that's my whole point. I'm now teaching you, like I was hopefully teaching the jury, the points by walking through baby steps with maybe a little bit of repetition along the way. Not too much, but a little bit of repetition. Okay, that was my impression. Yes, when you read this record, correct? Answer, correct. There is, sir, a big problem. I don't mean a little problem. Big problem with your opinion. Do you know what it is? Like a really big problem. Do you know what it is? Okay. Do I hear any objections or anything? Why? I'm saying to him, you have a big problem with your opinion here. And do you agree with me? And he said, no, I'm not guessing on the stand. And I said, why don't you look at the patient name, sir? You see, by the way, if we can just put this down for a minute, what happens here is that, and I have to give you a little bit of background. When you do fertility testing treatment, they do the husband and the wife. They do the two together. So there's now going to be blood work for Tony Mateo and blood work for Suzanne Mateo. So now you have to look at whose blood work this really is. And he's not guessing, but I'm going to help him not guess. Patient comment, it says, spouse Suzanne Mateo. Platelet count 146. So look at the name. He says Suzanne W. Mateo. Question. Spouse Suzanne, who is the actual patient on this 146,000 low platelet? Answer, who, sir? Who? He doesn't even say who it is. We all now know in front of the jury that it is the husband's blood work which was low, not the patient's blood work. And he says, sir, I am dumbfounded. I thought perhaps he, meaning Tony Mateo, was a physician, had ordered the test, and the patient was Suzanne Wester Mateo, which I saw on the top of the lab slip. See, Tony Mateo patient, Suzanne Mateo. His is the one that's 146. Now we have only one thing left to find out. What do we need to find out? What is hers? We're getting there. Question. Well, the answer is correct. I figured, why not pause for a commercial break? And the answer is, are you embarrassed, sir, right now? I'm shocked. I'm absolutely shocked. I'm not embarrassed. I'm absolutely shocked. It takes more to embarrass him than this. That's kind of what you get out of that. And the answer, the next question is patient name. What does it say after patient name? Suzanne Mateo. Anthony Mateo. And what does it say about patient comment, spouse? And it says, sir, I totally missed it. Missed it. See, now we're getting somewhere. Blew it. Now, this is a fault that I have. I confess to it. I can't leave like with missed it. It's like not in my nature, pardon me. So I like wanted him to characterize it. I believe that one of the great things that lawyers can do in the courtroom is have witnesses characterize things, because you're entitled to ask for characterizations and for the kinds of things that I'm asking for. So I want to know if he blew it. Let's see what he says. I'm not saying I blew it. Now, what do you think the jury was thinking? Answer. Question. But there's blood work for Suzanne Mateo, Suzanne Wester, the same day. Let's mark it, provide it, hand it to court officer, Cephas, and who wrote me a note, which I still have, which in this particular courtroom there was a line, and you were not allowed to walk over the line. And I have underneath my glass on my office desk, Margaret's shaking her head, a piece of court reporter paper where the court officer wrote, if you cross the line, and he meant that line, quote, you're going to give me grief. And here's the answer. I do, sir. Well, let's look at it. My audience is waiting. Here's Suzanne Wester Mateo. Correct? Correct, it appears so. Question? Well, do you take back the opinion that it was appropriate to have this patient on heparin therapy because she has a low platelet syndrome? That's the ultimate question. Is he now going to withdraw his opinion because it's based on a faulty premise? And here's the answer. Sir, would you? That was like a long pause. You know? Now you know, like, we're really kind of, you know, we're dancing here. You know? Please. I was functioning on the opinion, blah, blah, blah. I never thought otherwise, and I'm incredibly sorry to this court and to this jury. He's not sorry to me, by the way. And the answer is, we accept your apology. Like, we all do. The fact of the matter is, the patient had a platelet count of 235,000. Correct? Yes. And that would be a normal platelet count. Answer? Perfectly normal. Question? The normal range being 171 to 372. Answer? Correct. No indication of thrombophilia. Answer? Perfectly normal. According to her physician, she would not have been on aspirin or therapy. Now he's just going further. And would not, nor would I have advised it. Thank you, sir. When is the time? What is the time of the next plane back to Chicago? I know. Okay. Now, all right. We are now 45 minutes from drinking. The next one I have to pick out of what I call the potpourri. Kind of an interesting case. It was a case where we selected a jury. It also was actually in Lehigh County. Selected a jury, and the case settled. But not before we had a very interesting voir dire. And here's some of the things which make this interesting. The case involved Rafon West. It was the subject of some notoriety and some publicity, and the subject of a number of newspaper and television reports. Involved an interesting situation. Involved Rafon West. Rafon was an intravenous drug user. And intravenous drug users carry with them a higher risk for spinal abscesses. It's just a fact of life. And frankly, it's something that healthcare providers, especially in emergency rooms, should be aware of, and it's common knowledge. And it's also something that physicians should clearly know about, and it's a red flag. What is the best fact in the case, which is that the client is an intravenous drug user, is also, to state the obvious, the worst fact in the case for the plaintiff. And during voir dire, I asked the question, how many in this among this panel could not give a fair trial in an otherwise meritorious medical malpractice claim to a man who was an intravenous drug user? And what percentage of the hands went up in the room? And by the way, I get all of this about Philadelphia County and all of that stuff, but those same hands I would venture to say would go up in any county. It was half of the room, 60% of the room, with another 20% lying. So we have a great percentage. Well, here was the defendant's problem in the case. This case became poster child for something called poor medicine by teleradiology. How many have heard of teleradiology? When you go to the emergency room in the middle of the night and you need an x-ray, whether it's a chest x-ray to rule out a pneumothorax or an x-ray for a broken leg, unless you're in an academic medical center, it is very likely that your x-ray is going to be read somewhere in the world where it is daytime. Most commonly India. but other places as well. So when the defense counsel got up to ask the question to the panel, my kind of corollary question, and said, well, let's just say that, you know, the you go to the hospital and you learn that your x-ray really wasn't read on site, that's a nice way to put it, but rather was read, you know, off-site, let's say, you know, like someplace like, India. How many of you could not be fair to the healthcare provider under that circumstance? And I think there were more hands against than for the heroin intravenous drug user, because people don't like it. It's just a fact of life. There's a factor, at least I find it. So we have a case here where Rafon goes in and he's in extremis. And by the way, you're going to see on the some of the testimony live by video conference, me sitting in the plush conference rooms of Galco Technologies on the 51st floor of One Liberty, or 50 whatever floor it is on One Liberty, and defense counsel and two physicians somewhere in Mumbai, and I conduct an examination of them on the question of whether it is important for a radiologist to have an understanding of the clinical history. As in, you know how you think it's going to work, the radiologist does the film, and then he comes up, or the doctor goes down to the radiology room and looks at the film with him, and they kind of decide, like you see on House, where they're looking at it together. Well, they're not looking at it like on House. One person is in, literally, India, and one person is, in this case, in a hospital, in St. Luke's Hospital in Allentown or Bethlehem. So here goes. This is this is the setup for examination, which I thought you might find interesting for a number of reasons. One, I think it demonstrates that you can conduct hopefully a good, if not excellent, examination of a witness literally across a few oceans. And there's nothing lost. And secondly, the technology that's involved in doing that, which is elaborate, but something that we all can master. And third, the substance of it, which again, at this late hour, I thought you might enjoy. So I have a series of clips. And we're going to start with the first one, which has to do with the defendant who lists on his curriculum vitae, a fertile ground usually for cross-examination, lists on his curriculum vitae that his address, his business address, is in Connecticut, which, by the way, he was a Yale grad. These were not physicians who were poorly trained. But he is being questioned about where his address was. I believe in starting with the basics. So here goes. I have your curriculum vitae handy somewhere. This is the additions to it. Your CV, which was provided, says staff radiologist, teleradiology solutions, 205 Church Street. It's page one of our bait stamped matters. New Haven, Connecticut, 06510. Where are you located today, sir?
Today I'm in Bangalore.
Is 205 Church Street, third floor, really your office, sir?
It is the corporate office of the company which we use for you, as far as I know, that we use for US-based correspondence.
But your office is located where, sir?
At present, I work out of my home in Mumbai.
Okay, that's a starter. Now, the next clip that I have to show you is something really important. These things, at least in my view, are not only important for us as lawyers, we are consumers of healthcare. And these are the kinds of things that I think we all would want to know about. And the next clip shows you how they design a form. It's approximately 2 minutes, and I'm going to go to clip 2. I'm going to tell them about clip 4. I had a clip. I'm not going to show it to you for the sake of time. And by the way, for those of you who are planning, I'm going to go about another half hour. I know it may go a little bit over, but I want you to know where we're headed. So I'm not killing you at the end and you're thinking, when's he going to be over? If everybody would indulge me, that would be terrific. So what we have is the next clip where I show that there are four different places. They design the form, yet the clinical doctors don't fill out anything. And I point out, to, among other things, that you know you have email. By the way, it's OK to be there. It's OK to be, as I like to say, a few oceans away. But but you can still get the information. And they didn't have the basic information filled out. And what I went in the next clip, which runs about 1.53 minutes, which is probably a little bit better, this is clip two, Margaret, is me pointing out all the things that were in the medical records that were never told to the doctor in India. So let's take a look at that. And I may cut it, actually, once you get a flavor. OK, Margaret? Let's put up exhibit 18. Now, let's look at the method of the patient's arrival at 1507. This patient, you see where it says patient states, first sentence towards the right side, patient states pain all across mid-back. You see that? And all across abdomen, can't walk. Can't breathe because pain gets worse. Was that information provided to you?
No.
Had that information been provided to you, would you have looked at this film in a different light, sir?
Yes.
Yes or no?
I probably would have.
And
that's called making
look
progress against
what it
the
says
other
further.
Defendant.
Worse if lying on back. And then it goes further and says, pain worse with palpation. Do you see that?
Yes.
None of that information was provided to you, correct?
Correct.
And you didn't ask for any more information, which obviously was there and could have been provided to you, correct?
Yes.
Would you
agree with me, sir, in retrospect, that you should have had that information?
It would have been good to have that information.
If you had that information, you wouldn't have read that x-ray as, quote, no osseous changes, correct?
Yes.
You would have focused in on the fact that there was a prominent finding at T89, correct?
Yes, I would have probably focused in a little bit more on that finding.
So it is important that the radiologist has that kind of information. Now, where we go from here is, if you can believe this, two separate occasions. Not once, but this man reports back to the emergency room a second time. And in the second, in this clip, what I'm showing you is he had a wildly elevated white count and a SED rate, which showed that he was infected. I just want to give you a little flavor of it before I get to the best, what I think is the best part. Go ahead.
And look at the white blood count in this patient. Had you seen this before, Dr. Kalyanpur?
And by the way, again, from a practice point of view, this is an example, I think, of how you can display a medical chart, some complicated medical information, pre-marked, pulled out and enlarged, literally from a long distance away, and still have the witness in front of you to do it. Let's move on, Margaret, because I want to save some time. I'll get to the punchline in this, which is, and I'll give you time to reload, which is our clip six for internal purposes, where I get to what this x-ray really looked like. Really looked like, and what was really missed here. Okay.
You see that area that just lights up in front of you, as in you don't have to be a radiologist to see it?
There is some sclerosis at the end plates at T8 and T9.
Some sclerosis at the end plates of T8 and T9. Do you see how T8 and T9 is significantly whiter on both sides, even to a layperson's eye. Do you see that, sir?
Yes, I do.
Do you see any other level that has that kind of finding, sir?
No.
Does it stick out like a sore thumb, sir?
It has an appearance that is significantly different from the adjacent intervertebral disc spaces.
Well, it could look like that, or it could look like there's an infectious process going on, correct?
If it looks like an infectious process that's going on, it would be... It is possible that it can look like an infectious process, yes.
And finally, the last clip, which is just less than a minute as well. It sticks out like a sore thumb. Isn't that the right question?
Let's look very specifically at the finding. There is something called pitting on that, on those vertebral bodies, correct?
Do you mean by there being some irregularity at the end plates? Yes, I'll agree with you on that.
You don't see it at any of the other levels with that kind of prominence, do you, sir?
Not as prominently, no.
When you wrote no osseous changes, you actually saw that particular slide before your very eyes. Is that correct?
Yes.
That certainly, sir, is evidence of an osseous change, correct?
Correct. And as I mentioned to you, I told you why I didn't mention it in the report as well. Would you like me to say that again?
No, you said it 20 times, sir. But what I wanted to pin down was that you said no osseous change when in fact you had osseous, a prominent osseous change right in front of your very eyes. Can we agree to that?
Yes.
And that was that. And I thought you'd like to see the kind of the whole way that that gets packaged down to the fact that indeed, there was the kind of change that should have been there. The reason I'm playing the clinical issues in the face of such an obvious change is I have clinical doctors who clearly didn't provide them information. But the fact of the matter is you have an x-ray that looks like that. And that was that. Moving right along in the potpourri, I'm gonna show you what I believe. By the way, how am I doing on the entertainment factor? I want to show the one that I think I like the most. It's really old, and it's really hazy, and it's really faded. And I want to do it in two ways. I want to set it up by telling you a little bit about the case in less than a minute. Many years ago, this is a case that tried in Philadelphia County. I know we tried it in front of Judge Fields. The case lasted for weeks. I think we settled it towards the very, very end. The case involved Dennis Richardson. And Dennis was a boxer. He was a very large man who sustained a horrible brain injury when he got in the ring with a heavyweight contender whose name was Prince Charles Williams. And Prince Charles walloped him. They were Philly guys, and he walloped him in the Champs Gym, this is many, many years ago. Dennis sustained, and he's a man who's 6'4", 240 pounds, very big guy, but he sustained a hematoma. And he was taken to the most immediate hospital in the vicinity. And they made a diagnosis which was correct. As a side story, which I haven't told in a long time, which strikes me as kind of fun to tell in a room full of a lot of folks who are my friends, I can remember the case very well because one of the things that I had to do, like any good lawyer, was to go to the actual scene of the event. So I wanted to get up and into Champ's Gym. And I called my friend Jimmy Binns, and I said, hey, Jimmy, there are like these boxers. Do you think we can go up? Sure, no problem. Went in, knocked on the door. It's kind of like a speakeasy. You know, somebody looks out, says, okay, lets us in. I walk in. Jimmy says, assalamu alaikum. I'm like stuck with, you know, like me. And a guy, short, middle-aged, sticks out his hand and says to me, so you're running for mayor? As it turned out, Dennis, it's like a favorite story. It's a true story. It's like one of a million that you collect when we all do what we do. So Dennis has this subdural hematoma. It is diagnosed around the corner, literally, from the gym at the community hospital. They recognize that he needs to have it evacuated. It's a medical emergency. And so they do the next best thing, which is to call 911. You call 911, for those of you who have been in Philadelphia long enough and remember the former mayor, Frank Rizzo, you will remember Frank Rizzo's characterization of 911 as dial a prayer. And they did that, and the nurses called, they waited and waited and waited. My beef with them was they waited and waited and waited and waited. And I said, gee, why didn't you do something rather than having a man forgotten sitting on a gurney or laying on a gurney in the hall waiting to be shipped out for over an hour when it's a medical emergency? They brought in a very prominent local head of a emergency room, of course, as they say in cases in controversy, as we call them, to say the exact opposite of what Tom Klein was saying, which was they did their job, they called 911, we can't have no control over this. What do you want anyway? What do you plaintiffs' lawyers want anyway? And so I decided I needed a way, after hearing his well-executed presentation on direct examination, to try to poke a few holes in it. And there was no premeditation here. I just kind of thought of what you're about to see on the spot. I want to give it to you in the format that I've been presenting some of these things, which is the Q&A. And then I want you to see, knowing what it says, the actual tape. I have done this a number of times. I find that this works best, and so that's how I want to do it. So here's the testimony. Dr. Kelly, let me ask you this. There are times when you don't get certain non-emergent services, service in everyday life. If they don't happen quickly, you make a callback. Remember, that's my case, correct? Yes. Question. For example, sir, you make an appointment. It's not life or death. It's not whether you're brain damaged for the rest of your life. It has to do with whether you're going to make the theater or dinner. You've had that circumstance, haven't you, where you call a taxi? I know some would say in this room, this is class warfare. This isn't fair to cross-examine this way, but here's where we go. Answer, yes. And the taxi doesn't come for a half hour. You call back, don't you? Yes. Dr. Kelly, you ever order pizza out? No. You never, I mean, like, here's a guy, you know, like, why are you doing this to me? Like, you got to order pizza out. No, you never order pizza delivery? No, it gives me heartburn. All right, now I know he's gotten the best of me. I lose, I go home. How many think that? Okay, so we then go to the next, like, that's fair enough. How about without the tomato? Ever order any kind of food to be delivered to the home? Answer. I like the kind, why, how about the tomato? Sure, I like Chinese food maybe. There we go. Got something. Now we have something going. Answer. Okay, we'll go with Chinese food. You place the order, you're waiting 45 minutes, they still don't come with the food. Get it? Like the ambulance? You call back and say, I'm going to do this more dramatically than's on the tape. I could do it better today. You say, where's my food? Here's the answer. Yes. Sir, for an ambulance for Dennis Richardson, he deserved the same kind of call that you'd make for your taxi cab when you're waiting for the theater or the Chinese food that you were going to be delivered, correct? Yes. He would deserve a lot better than if your food was running late, correct? Answer, yes. All right, here's the videotape. I like it better on video. I've changed my mind.
Dr. Kelly, let me ask you this. There are times when you don't get certain non-emergent services, services that are in everyday life, that if they don't happen quickly, you make a call back, correct?
Yes.
For example, sir, you want to make an appointment. It's not life or death. It's not whether you're brain damaged for the rest of your life. It has to do with whether you're going to make the theater or dinner. You've had that circumstance, haven't you? Where you'd call a taxi?
Yes.
The taxi doesn't come for a half an hour. Call back, don't you?
Yes.
Dr. Kelly, you ever order pizza out?
Objection.
I object and move to strike.
You never order pizza delivery?
No.
You ever order any kind of...
Gives me heartburn.
That's fair enough. How about without the tomato?
See, he got the best.
You ever order any kind of food to be delivered to the home?
Sure, like Chinese food, maybe.
Okay, we'll go with Chinese food. You place the order, and you're waiting for 45 minutes, and they still don't come with the food. You call back, and you say, is my order on the way, correct?
Yes.
Objection. Objection.
And, sir, for an ambulance, for Dennis Richardson, he deserved the same kind of call that you would make for your taxi cab when you were waiting to go to the theater or for the Chinese food that you didn't get delivered, correct?
Objection.
Yes. He would deserve a lot better than if your Chinese food was running late, correct?
Yes.
Okay. I want to switch gears. I want to try to accomplish two things, and I hope I can do them in enough brevity to make it worthwhile. I was trying to make a decision between the two, and I want to do both for different reasons. I'm going to do Thatcher. Is that okay? I mess you up? Okay. I'm going to start with the setup with Channel 3. Tell me when you're ready. Earlier this year, I had a very challenging case. Involved a young woman who was treated by a unlicensed psychologist for over the course of many years. And to say that he took advantage of her in the most perverse way that you can imagine would be an understatement. She was a very troubled young teen with many, many problems. And I bring it to you today for a number of reasons. One being, frankly, I'm proud of some of the accomplishments that we had here that are possible in civil litigation that go beyond monetary awards. Secondly, there's, I believe, a need for public awareness, and we are still actually working with people in the field to try to change the law. Right now, a unlicensed therapist can continue to practice in this state with impunity, so long as there's a supervisor. And this was a case where we took the supervisors to task along with the perpetrator. I want to show you a brief news clip because it had public awareness. And then I want to show you the culmination of what I perceive, just as in the book that Bob Zausner wrote about the good that can come out of civil litigation. We are often interested in settling cases and pushing forward and getting on to the next case. And my view of it is a little bit different. There are those occasions where there are those cases which either need to be publicly aired or need to be publicly tried or some combination. In this case, we avoided a trial with a trial judge who allowed me the flexibility to craft an agreement which accomplished more than you could actually obtain in the pleading that was pled in this case in the complaint, because you can't plead for damages to have someone agree never to practice in the field of psychology again, which is what we accomplished. So take a look at the piece. It runs about 2 minutes. It's a standard news piece. And then we'll move forward from there. And then I want to accomplish one other case with everybody's indulgence. Here goes.
And now to an Eyewitness News exclusive. A young woman goes in for therapy, but what her therapist did next, she says, is unethical. A warning, at times, her story is disturbing and it's graphic. Eyewitness News reporter Valerie Levesque has details.
Alyssa Thatcher was 13 years old when she started to see a therapist in Lehigh Valley. But when she turned 17, she says her therapist violated the patient-therapist relationship. Alyssa was questioned about it in this sworn pretrial deposition.
Touching, kissing, using a sexual toy.
Alyssa was a young girl suffering from an eating disorder and depression. This was the therapist she saw, Andy Smith, an unlicensed psychologist. Alyssa's attorney, Tom Klein.
He was in a position to manipulate her and to prey on her emotionally.
Smith had been previously kicked out of his PhD program for having a sexual relationship with a patient's mother. Alyssa saw Smith over the next several years as he moved from four different practices in the Lehigh Valley.
Anything else in terms of sexual things that he talked with about you?
What he wanted to do to me, what he wanted me to do to him.
She was primed to be lured into sexual contact in a very grotesque and vulgar way.
These are the pictures used as evidence in a civil lawsuit. Some we can show you on television, others are too explicit. This picture, Alyssa's attorney says, was taken by Smith.
Provocative, some vulgar, many would be seen by most of us as pornographic.
In court, Smith testified about the sexual contact.
She performed oral sex on me.
A settlement was reached for $1.8 million against Smith, along with the psychologist and a psychiatrist who allowed him to work in their practices without properly looking into his background. In Pennsylvania, an unlicensed psychologist can work under a licensed one, but must be supervised. Lisa and her attorney hope no one will have to endure what she went through.
This case falls so outside the boundaries of human decency.
Now, Smith's attorney did not return our phone calls for comment. Smith never faced criminal charges because Alyssa was 17 when the sexual contact began. In Pennsylvania, the age of consent is 16. From the News Center, Valerie Levesque, CBS 3 Eyewitness News.
Certainly disturbing to know that can happen. Valerie, thank you.
Social network. Now, in terms of switching gears within this case, I want to take you to the movies for a minute. How many have seen Social Network? You'll spend another just few seconds with it, 45 seconds to be exact, to look at a scene which has to do with, in my opinion, the wrong question. I want to show you the wrong question, and then hopefully in Alyssa's case, when I cross-examined the expert witness, how to ask the right question. At least I hope so. So here goes.
Let me rephrase this. You sent my client 16 emails. In the first 15, you didn't raise any concerns.
Is that a question?
In the 16th email, you raised concerns about the site's functionality. Were you leading them on for 6 weeks?
No.
Then why didn't you raise any of these concerns before?
It's raining.
I'm sorry?
It just started raining.
Mr. Zuckerberg, do I have your full attention?
No.
Do you think I deserve it?
What?
Do you think I deserve your full attention?
I had to swear an oath before we began this deposition, and I don't want to perjure myself, so I have a legal obligation to say no.
Okay, no. You don't think I deserve your attention?
I think if your clients want to sit on my shoulders and call themselves tall, they have a right to give it a try, but there's no requirement that I enjoy sitting here listening to people lie. You have part of my attention. You have the minimum amount. The rest of my attention is back at the offices of Facebook, where my colleagues and I are doing things that no one in this room, including and especially your clients, are intellectually or creatively capable of doing. Did I adequately answer your condescending question?
For those of us who are on this side of the bar, that's not the question to ask. How many times did he ask that question? Do I deserve your attention? Three times. And he was told no. Here's less than 5-second clip. You have to pay close attention when you just say to somebody, give me your attention. When the witness is looking down at the papers, how many of those who practice have had the witness look at the papers? You know, they're going to tell you that they're disinterested in what you have to say. Do not ask, do I deserve your attention? I'm not sure there's anything deserving. Here goes. Very quick. You got to be on your toes.
All right, now, there was a specific code requirement for which would have provided an opportunity. There were, by the way, there were, if I can have your attention, there were many opportunities here.
May I have your attention? Okay, now, I want to just briefly go through with Alyssa's case the consent decree. I was convinced, both myself and frankly by the judge in this case, Judge McGinley, that while my gut wanted a trial and my brain wanted a trial, my heart didn't want a trial. And I thought, what can I accomplish here that would actually be better than some resounding number, some large amount of money? And here's what we came up with. I had sent the defendants, literally over the weekend of the trial, a consent agreement, which was read in open court for all to see and read by the defendant. You saw him, you saw what happened here, you saw what we were facing. And yet I had a young woman who had, among other things, relied on this litigation to actually achieve a real measure of justice. I actually counseled her that if she hung in there, she was going to commit suicide, that we would get through this in a way that would be right, to use the euphemistic way I went about it. And here's what we accomplished. The defendant said, I wish to address Alyssa Satcher and her parents and her family. Two, that I acknowledge my misconduct, which was negligent and wrong and violating the codes. Three, that I took advantage of a vulnerable, mentally ill teenager who I'd been entrusted to help. My misconduct involved engaging in sexual activity, taking photos. I admit about the photos. I agree that I shall destroy any and all photos of naked women taken by me on my computer and delete images of Alyssa Satcher. She is a victim and in no way to be blamed. Next, my misconduct caused severe psychological and emotional harm. Next, I am ashamed of my actions. I have embarrassed myself, my family, my profession. At the time I was charged, I was not licensed. I acknowledge that the events were not the first time that I had engaged in unethical sexual conduct. I publicly acknowledge that I was dismissed from a PhD program. I agree never to attempt to practice psychotherapy or any form of counseling in the United States, either alone or under the supervision of a psychologist. I agree that any future resume will be corrected to reflect that I'm not a PhD candidate. In the period 2001 through 2005, Pennsylvania law, and by the way, it's still the law, permitted me to treat Alyssa Thatcher without a license. In the period I was supposed to be supervised, they billed and profited from this. I improperly profited from this 161 times. My take was $7,265, and by the way, I made him make restitution for this, as he should. This is a man who would have a young woman come into his office to provide treatment, who would who would counsel her for 10 or 15 minutes. She would literally perform oral sex on him. He, in turn, would then, his supervisors would then bill Blue Cross and Blue Shield, and he would put his hand out for the copay check, if you can believe it. Next, I did not act alone. There were three others who were negligent. I encouraged the Pennsylvania Legislature and State Board to adopt stricter regulations of unlicensed therapists. Join the bandwagon, I asked them. 21, I agree to the entry of a judgment for $1 million because, believe it or not, something else that you might not have known before you stepped in this room, psychologists have insurance policies which have a provision that provides $1 million in coverage, except in the event where there's sexual misconduct. Well, what do therapists do when they do something wrong? Duh. So we took a judgment, and we're going to litigate this issue with the carrier. Next, and he agrees to full cooperation. So, and on and on. So I wanted to give you a sense, as I warmed you up with a lot of funny things, of the kinds of things that I believe we can do in civil litigation which can really change, really dramatically change. It may sound trite, it may sound overused, but can we as lawyers and judges make a difference, the kind of difference which will change individual lives, the kind of difference which will change product safety, the kind of difference which will change almost every aspect of life as it impacts on us, our children, our families, our loved ones, our grandchildren, we can actually do it. And I think that's the spirit of what a bench bar is all about. It's about coming together to exchange ideas, and I hope that I provided some maybe small measure of things for people to think about as we all go and get drunk.